Flaws in a DNA sequencer could lead to hacks. Magecart is back with some shiny upgrades and cloud backups for 2FA codes. You better make sure those are encrypted. All that coming up now on ThreatWire. Greetings, I am Shannon Morse and this is ThreatWire for May 2nd, 2023. This is your summary of the threats to our security, privacy, and internet freedom. Big news, if you have not seen any of my recent ThreatWire episodes, I'm about to hit 100,000 subscribers on my main channel, which is called Morse Code. As I am recording this, I'm about 100 subs away. Oh my gosh, it's so close, it's happening. My channel is youtube.com/ShannonMorse. You can help me hit that goal by subscribing to my channel where I post tons of security and privacy content so you don't have to be your family's tech support. Let's go ahead and jump right into the news this week, all about DNA sequencing. Now, CISA and the FDA posted an advisory about Illumina's Universal Copy Service, which is a DNA sequencing device used in medical labs all across the world. The UCS has two vulnerabilities that could allow for remote code execution attacks and malicious uploads, along with admin-level controls. Now, since these devices are used in 140 different countries for DNA sequencing, including in clinical and research settings, biotech and pharmaceuticals, an attack on these systems could have major, major consequences. One of the vulnerabilities even has a CVE marked at the highest severity, which is 10 out of 10. An attacker could listen to network traffic and pivot to other vulnerable machines on the same network. They could modify settings, access proprietary data, and elevate their privileges. They could also impact genomic data results used in clinical diagnosis to provide incorrect or altered results. The two CVEs are tracked as CVE 2023-1968 and 1966. If you do work at one of these companies that uses these devices, admins should update their products, configure account credentials, close firewall ports, isolate networks, and use VPNs if you need to do remote access. Magecart is back and it had an upgrade. In this new campaign, Magecart, which is a term used to define criminal groups who use online skimming to steal customer information and payment data from online retailers, well, they are using very realistic looking checkout and payment screens to steal payment data from users. In some cases, these new skimmers look more legitimate than the actual retailer sites. This is because Magecart is being deployed as a modal, a part of the main checkout page, instead of redirecting users to a third-party payment processor site like you would with PayPal. Using these kinds of forms creates more trust from the user because it looks like you've never even left the retailer site at all. The malicious payment pages use JavaScript scripts to capture data that is entered by a customer. The fake page siphons the credit card data, and then a fake error is displayed to the user saying the payment was canceled or declined. They wait a few seconds and the page refreshes to the actual website checkout page, where they can then enter their details once more and the payment is then successful. The attackers also use session cookies to mark the user's session as being completed. So if, for some reason, a user chooses to go back and try to pay for something on that site a second time, they will just see the legitimate cart, as the malicious screen will not be displayed a second time. The attackers appear to be using different domains with different deployments for each and every single store that they are deploying this on. Malwarebytes researchers discovered the modals were deployed across a variety of e-commerce sites and in a variety of different languages as well. They listed indicators of compromise on their blog post for administrators. Biggest of shoutouts to my Patreon supporters, especially my golden s'mores and their fur babies. We got a new one this week for making the show possible, since we do not have ads on this show at all other than Patreon. And a huge thank you to ktwares.com, Daniel, She, Yuri, and Alfred for being a part of the s'mores at patreon.com/ShannonMorse. That is my new Patreon page for the show. I've mentioned it before, but I will again, because I know not everybody watches every single episode of ThreatWire. I will be posting all of the perks for patrons, including early access to the video. So if you are currently a patron on the ThreatWire page, you can switch over to the new page so you don't lose access to your perks, because I will be switching out the entire ThreatWire page over to the Morse code Patreon page later this year. Let's go ahead and finish out today's episode with my last top story, all about Google Authenticator. Now, a huge shout out to Joel this week for sharing this story. For years, I have recommended Google Authenticator for two-factor authentication codes. And if you want some up-to-date videos about 2FA and why it's still highly recommended in 2023, you can check out my channel Morse code. I've done several episodes on it. Google Authenticator has never had a ton of fancy features, but the app now supports Google account syncing, which means that you will have the ability to back up your one-time codes to your Google account. Now, for years, if you lost a device that you used to generate 2FA codes with the Google Authenticator app, you ran the risk of locking yourself out of your accounts unless you stored backup codes for each of those websites somewhere safe. But now that's not the case. So should you turn this on? Well, maybe not yet. This update means that you can snag those codes from any device where you are signed into the same Google account. It sounds great. Cloud backup of 2FA codes is optional and it has to be manually turned on by the user. That's also great. As such, somebody who is worried about their Google account being accessed by an attacker may not want to enable this feature, since allowing a malicious actor access to Google Authenticator means that they would have all of your one-time codes in their fingertips. Another problem that arose is the lack of end-to-end encryption for these backups. Researchers with MISC and Sophos shared posts about these concerns after analyzing network traffic as they uploaded 2FA codes. They found that the QR code for 2FA setup is viewable when uploaded, which also means that Google could see the websites that you use for 2FA and be able to read data like your account details. There are no passphrases to encrypt the data before it leaves your phone either. Now, Google stated the Google Authenticator data is encrypted in transit and at rest, and they do plan to enable end-to-end encryption for Google Authenticator soon. But how soon is soon? Well, we don't necessarily know. But if they offer encryption before the code backups are sent to the cloud, aka somebody else's computer, then it will be very convenient as well. End-to-end encryption is available in the alternative app, which is called Authy, and it does require a passphrase to upload backups to the cloud with that app. Google should be enabling something similar, but the caveat is if you lose encryption for your passphrase, you could also lose access to your 2FA code recovery via backups as well. So keep that in mind. Never forget your passphrase whenever they do enable this feature. I'm Shannon Morse, and I will see you on the internet.